Hi, everybody. Peter Greenberg here on the second Thursday of June, 2023. Crazy stuff happening today, especially with the wildfires in Canada and the east coast of the United States. I'll talk about that in a second. First of all, let me tell you where we're doing our global travel update from. I'm on the bridge of the Octantis, a Viking ship that is a special purpose-built ice-class ship that spends at least 4 months a year in the Antarctic. But in the summer months, they bring it up to the Great Lakes. And that's where I am right now. I'm on the bridge. I'll show you. There we are. Very cool place to be. We're at anchor right here. And I'll tell you where we are a little bit later. But first, let me just introduce the captain who's with me. Captain Gustafson, come on in. He's an Antarctic veteran. But now this summer, he's in the Great Lakes. Yeah. We started this trip in Milwaukee, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And that was Lake Michigan.
Yes.
And then?
Then we went up Sioux Locks to Lake Huron. And now we ended in Lake Superior in Thunder Bay.
Right, and that's where we're going to end the trip tomorrow. The interesting thing, don't leave me yet. No. The interesting thing, of course, is that this is also an expedition ship. We've got 17 Zodiacs. We've got two deep-sea submersibles. Actually, I went to the bottom of Lake Huron the other day. We actually went down on the sub. Amazing experience. They're doing a lot of research on the ship. We've got a number of expedition leaders, marine biologists, weather analysts. They're all here, and it's also a cruise ship. A great experience. Of water, I should say, bodies of water that most Americans really don't know and appreciate. Yeah. It's true. And the captain is a man of few words, as you can see. So before I do the global travel update, any last minute words of advice?
No, all good. As long as you don't touch any button, then I'm happy.
No, don't touch anything.
Thank you very much.
All right, Captain,
thank you again.
Thanks for letting me on the bridge.
My pleasure, thank you.
All right, so now let's get down to serious stuff. I talked about the wildfires. They're worse than ever. We're talking about 300 uncontrolled fires in Canada. And of course, that smoke is down. You've already seen those terrible pictures from New York, which had the worst air quality in the world yesterday. And a very difficult situation. I'll be flying out of Toronto tomorrow, maybe, because of course, the smoke situation is just as bad as ever. We had a ground stop 2 days ago. We had a ground stop yesterday. And about 7:30 this morning, the FAA issued another ground stop. The good news is they moved that to a ground delay. Operations at Kennedy, at least, were running about 54 minutes late. LaGuardia, about 2 hours late. Yesterday, 250 flights were canceled out of Toronto. This isn't going away anytime soon. It's a very serious situation. When you have that many uncontrolled fires, you don't really have much of a choice unless they just burn themselves out. There's not enough man and woman power to really fight those fires. It's truly out of control. All right, let's talk about some other things that are going on this week. First of all, other than the wildfires, I want you to listen to our radio show on Saturday because we're going to have a long extended conversation with our good friend Mike Boyd about something I've been talking about for weeks on this show, and that is the current situation with frequent flyer programs at airlines, so-called loyalty programs, and how some of you might actually argue and make the case that they're bordering on, well, a clinical definition of fraud. And what you need to do about that. And it's not pretty. It is not pretty. Also, on the show this weekend, on the radio show, I spent time with the Minister of Tourism of Jamaica, Edmund Bartlett, and for one particularly important reason. Back in May, the U.S. State Department issued a level 3 travel advisory for the whole country of Jamaica. Let me explain what that means. A State Department advisory is usually a negative connotation, as you all know. We've talked about this before. In this situation, a level 1 means travel with normal caution. I have no idea what that means. Level 2 is travel with increased caution. Most of you at this point are putting plywood on your windows. And level 3 is reconsider travel. You're already in the safe room in the basement. And that's the level 3 that was issued for Jamaica. And in the issuing of that travel advisory, the State Department also said that all U.S. government personnel were also forbidden to travel to many areas of Jamaica because of crime and rape and robbery. Now, I've always argued, and I will continue to argue, that if there's a riot in Cincinnati, it doesn't mean I can't go to Cleveland. And the same applies to Jamaica. We continue to paint with too broad a brushstroke. I go to Jamaica 4 or 5 times a year. I have never been threatened. I've never been attacked. And I've been all over the country. I'm not just sitting in a beach resort with a pina colada stuck up my nose. And so I would urge everyone to embrace just the notion of common sense, the way you pack, the way you dress, whether you're going to Jamaica or whether you're going to Jacksonville. It doesn't matter. With the exception of areas like Syria and Yemen and Ukraine and a few other hotspots around the world where no one's in control, really, I would go just about anywhere. Not because I'm being irresponsible, not because I'm just cavalier, not because I'm rolling the dice. No. Every time you travel, whether it's on the 405 in San Diego on the freeway, or whether you're on the Long Island Railroad, or whether you're just on a little hop, skip, and a jump flight between Los Angeles and San Francisco, you are always making a calculated risk. And so far, the odds are overwhelmingly in your favor, and they will maintain that percentage as long as you pack common sense. So listen in for that interview and conversation with the Minister of Tourism about what those State Department advisories, the impact that they really have, and what you need to know about that. One other housekeeping note before we get to a lot of your comments. I've been asked to be involved in something called the Roundtable at the legendary 92nd Street Y in New York. Many of you know that organization. They have great talks, great speakers. It starts on June 21st. I'm going to be talking about, I'll be doing live reports every week. It's a part of a series that I'm doing on being the smartest traveler 2023. Everything from what the airlines won't tell you to what hotels won't tell you, what cruise lines won't tell you, what rental cars won't tell you. We're going to definitely expand on the frequent flyer program issue. We're going to answer your questions, and we're going to talk about safety and common sense and State Department advisories. That's just the beginning. So I hope you'll join me. It starts June 21st. We'll be coming live from Paris every week at 11 o'clock in the morning, starting on June 21st. So June 21st, the 28th, we'll take a break for the July 4th weekend, and we'll be back again on July 12th. So if you want more information, just go to roundtable.org, and we'll also show you the link on the screen today so you can sign up. And by the way, I'm also going to be answering questions, so I'm looking forward to our conversation. Let's go to the screen right now and see what we've got to see. Okay, hello from Harriet and Jim from Portugal. All right. I hope that you got through passport control in Lisbon, because it's crazy there. All right. Hi from Miami to John Lample, my good pal John. Lisa's saying, hi from Simi Valley. Just got my renewed passport in 8 weeks. Okay, you're moving fast. That's pretty good. Santa Monica from Jeff. Sue's saying hi from Bellingham, Washington. And says, sounds awesome what you're doing. It really is. You know, to get out on these waters, which are virtually unexplored, you know, but people forget that the Great Lakes, that's how people did commerce and still do. Here's a question for you. What's the largest body of water in North America? Which one is it? Anybody want to guess? Here's the answer. And if you get out an atlas or a map, you'll be blown away by it, because most of us don't even look at it. And then when we look at it, we go, oh, my God. The largest body of water in North America is not that far from here. And it's not one of the Great Lakes. It's Hudson Bay in Canada. It's enormous. I mean, it's unbelievable. All right. Camilla's saying hi from Tucson. Colleen is saying hi from San Francisco. Jean says, my sister and I would like to do a tour from Switzerland into Italy. Any tour companies you would recommend? Well, what makes you think you want to do a tour? You know, the distances are not great. You can either go by train or drive it. I'd like to know more about what you want to accomplish before I give you a recommendation of a tour company or any tour company. Okay. Mike says, I did Viking 2 years ago to circumnavigate Iceland. It was great. I've circumnavigated Iceland, Mike. I couldn't agree more. And you picked a good cruise line. They do a great job. Colleen signed up for the roundtable. Okay. All right. I'll see you on the roundtable, Colleen. All right. Michael's saying hi from Ohio. Eddie. Oh, my good pal from Eddie in Babylon. Yes, from beautiful, smoky Babylon. Those pictures are unbelievable. I'll be in New York to see them myself if I can get out of Toronto. Okay. Now, let's talk about some of the other questions you've asked. Here's one. Jeremy says, I have a trip planned for Quebec. Can you talk about the fire situation? Yes, I can. Well, we're in it. Now, we're a little bit west of it right here in Thunder Bay. We're about 3 hours from Toronto, 2.5 actually, but I'll be flying into it tomorrow. It's going to stay bad for at least another week to 10 days. The question is this. Is it so bad that they're going to stop airline operations? Well, they did so temporarily for the last 3 days in New York. They may have to do it again in Toronto. Yesterday, as I said, 250 planes delayed from there. But Quebec is a little bit better off than Toronto, just based on where it is on the map. So I think you'll be okay for the moment. Marty says, my son and I are flying to Edinburgh through Toronto. He from San Francisco, me from ORD. I haven't flown to Europe for quite some time. Will our luggage go straight through? We are returning from London. Where do we go through customs? Okay. First of all, you said you're going through Toronto. When? Because right now, again, delays in Toronto. But on a procedural level, let me give you the answer. If you're tagging your bags from San Francisco through Toronto, then your bags will connect in Toronto. You will not have to claim them in customs. You'll be a transit passenger. But when you come back and you're coming back to the United States, then you're going to have to get your bags in Toronto, go through U.S. Customs and passport control in Toronto. It's part of pre-clearance. We love pre-clearance. It's been around since 1952. Most people don't realize that. It's in Canada, the Bahamas, Bermuda. It's even in Abu Dhabi. It's in Ireland. And the beautiful thing about that is you do all that before you get on the plane so that when you land back in either San Francisco or Chicago, as you said, you just get your bags and go home. You're not standing in a long line to go through passport and immigration. So we love pre-clearance. And by the way, going through Canada normally is a very cool way to get to Europe. It's an even cooler way in many cases to get to Asia if you're on the West Coast. You just fly up to Vancouver and hop across. And in many cases, the airfare on Air Canada is cheaper than some of the other carriers, if you don't mind making one stop in Canada, either going or coming back. So you go through customs again in Toronto before you get on the plane. Okay, Judy says, what's the best sleep aid for overnight trips to Europe? Well, I can only tell you what works for me, all right? No alcohol, no coffee, right? Especially no caffeinated coffee. Just drink plenty of water. The key is hydration and plenty of it. Remember, the humidity at altitude is only about 15 to 20% of what it is on the ground, and you add pressure to that, and you'll feel it. So hydration helps you out a lot. My best sleep aid is I don't eat airline food. People don't eat airline food because they're hungry. They eat airline food because they're bored. Somebody puts a tray of something in front of you and you go, well, I have another 7 hours on the flight, so I might as well consume all of this. And then you really hate yourself for it. So bring your own snacks, but bring your own snacks that will also hydrate you, right? So bring fresh fruit. That always works. And I just want to make an appeal to anybody who's getting on a plane, please don't board the plane with a bag of McDonald's. Nothing smells worse than a half-eaten bag of French fries at 35,000 feet. Please don't do that. And bring some empty water bottles with you and fill them up after you clear security, because the flight attendants don't always come down the aisle when you want to drink. And my sleep aid to that is, if I feel like sleeping, I sleep. If I feel like working, I work. If I feel like watching the movie, I watch the movie. But the real sleep aid for me is what you do when you land, not when you fly. So not, no matter what time you land, and this could be a challenge for some of you, but I'll tell you what works for me. No matter what time you land, and many of the overnight flights land at 7 a.m, and guess what? Your room won't be ready anyway. So take a nice walk around the city, right? Or go to the gym, right? But do not succumb to either a heavy lunch or that afternoon nap. Do everything you can not to do that nap, not to have that lunch, because if you do, no one will see you for 3 days, and that includes you. And then stay up until 11 o'clock or midnight local time, and you will cycle, and you'll be fine. All right? Do what I do, you'll be fine. Laura says, can you please tell me what's on? Oh, about Vantage Deluxe Travel. Canceling all their trips 24 to 48 hours prior to departure, but not refunding the traveler's money. We have taken a lot of steps about Vantage Travel. They're based in Boston. We've talked with the Attorney General there and their Office of Consumer Affairs. They've been relatively successful in getting some money back, but there are still a lot of people who are left holding the bag. We're still investigating that. They do not answer their phones, even though they claim to still be in business. And based on the way they've done business, I would not book them right now under any circumstances. But keep in mind that we are still pursuing that story, Laura, because there are a lot of our listeners and a lot of our viewers who did get nailed during the pandemic and after the pandemic where people booked trips, they paid for them, and then they never got their money back. Again, if you paid with a credit card, you have rights, but you don't have rights 9 months after the fact. You have rights within 60 days of the fact under U.S. federal credit laws. So if you're still having problems with Vantage, and I haven't been in touch with you yet, if I have been in touch with you yet, you don't need to write me. But if I haven't been in touch with you yet, go ahead and email me, peter@petergreenberg.com, and we'll continue to pursue it with the Attorney General in the state of Massachusetts. Okay, Michael says, Iceland Air offers a nice stop with a several-day layover on the way to or from Europe. Yes, Iceland Air is one of a number of airlines that's offering free stopovers. Qatar Air, right? They're doing it in Doha. Turkish Air is doing it whether you're in economy or business. If you're in economy, they'll give you two free nights at a hotel. If you're ongoing somewhere else in their route system, and if you're in business class, they'll give you three free nights. It's a great deal. Okay. Joel says, why is Spirit Airlines always delayed in my experience compared to other airlines? I got news for you. Right now, their on-time performance at Spirit is really good. You know who else has great on-time performance? Hawaiian Air. So I don't. Maybe it was just your experience, but I've taken now probably four Spirit flights in the last 2 months, and they've either been on time or early. Now, do the seats recline? No. Is the in-flight food terrific? There is no in-flight food. They have Wi-Fi if you want to pay for it. But the bottom line is, you asked about on-time performance, and I have to tell you, they've been doing a pretty good job. All right, let's scroll down and talk about a few more things here. Hold on a second. I'm going to catch up with everybody. Give me a second here. Okay. Okay. Here we go. Michael says, how have all the fires in Canada affected air travel? A lot. Because it's not just Toronto. It's not just, that area. It's also where the wind is blowing, where nobody can control it. And so we're seeing Washington, D.C. today, basically flirting with a ground stop. Philadelphia. We might even see Boston. So it's not over yet. And of course, as we also know, whenever there's a weather incident, anytime it starts on the East Coast, which in this case in the U.S. it is, and all the flights heading west get affected, and all the flights on the West Coast heading east, they're not there. So on time, you'll see a number of delays and cancellations throughout the rest of this week for sure. Hopefully they're saying, but it's meteorology, so you can't bet on it. But they're saying we might actually get so much more stabilized by Saturday. But today and tomorrow are going to be bad days. That's the deal. Mike says one of his colleagues is on the same cruise as I am. Okay. Well, tell him to look out for me, Mike. Gene says we just want to do some sightseeing in the two countries, but not necessarily comfortable doing it on our own. Well, Gene, let me tell you something. You pick two countries where you can be comfortable doing it. The train system in Switzerland is phenomenal. And by the way, they are always on time. The train system in Italy is also lovely, and they're never on time. So you get to have a little bit of both. And you can also drive it if you want. But if you want a tour company, there are a number of really good ones. Trafalgar is good. Tauk is also excellent. Those are the two I'd recommend. They do a very, very good job. But make sure that the tour that you're booking, and this is key, doesn't consume every minute of the day. You need time to discover places on your own. So if they're going to book a lunch, let them give you 3 hours after lunch to just walk around and see stuff. It's just, I do not want to live on a bus, and neither do you. So make sure you look at these brochures very carefully, and then start fine-tuning the itinerary so that you're not a prisoner of a bus, right? You need the freedom to explore. That's the best thing about travel. It's when you discover things on your own, okay? Okay, Stephanie's saying, hey, hi from the Okeechobee Lodge. We were just there. Oh my goodness, hello, Stephanie. Please say hi to the owners for us. What a great location. What a fabulous location in Canada. Okay, Kimber says, flying through Warsaw to get to Prague on LOT. We have 1.5 hours to connect to another LOT flight. Will we need to clear immigration in Poland before we can connect? No, you won't need to clear immigration, but you may need to clear security again. It's hit and miss on that. But if you're flying on the same airline, you should be okay. I'm a little concerned that it's only 1.5 hours, but because the Warsaw airport is not outrageously large and you're on the same airline, you should be fine. But one other thing you need to do, and that is when you get to your connecting flight gate, take your bag tags, those barcoded tags that you were given, and go to the gate agent and ask them if they could please scan it and let you know that your bags were scanned and loaded on your flight. They can do that. They don't get asked to do it, but you're going to ask them to do it. Okay. Okay, Daniel says, I'm planning to go to Italy in August. Last two B&Bs I booked are asking me to email copies of the documents of the parties who will be staying at the B&B. Well, they just want to know who's going to be with you. And the reason for that is a number of countries are cracking down on B&B owners or hosts who are running hostels or hotels. And that's really not the nature of what B&B started out doing. It's also liability issues. They want to know how many people are going to be in the place with you. I think that's fair to ask. All right. Thank you for that nice note, Tembo. Janice is saying, what is the best way to get to Mallorca, Spain, from Newark, and then go to Porto in Portugal? Well, first of all, check United Airlines out, because they are literally flying to secondary and tertiary cities all over Europe this summer. They've really added to their route network. If for any reason they're not, and you want to save some money, then you can go through London and then go to a secondary airport, whether at Gatwick or Luton or Stansted, and fly one of the other airlines, maybe like EasyJet or Ryanair, to get to Mallorca. And then if you want to go to Porto, if you want to go to Porto from Mallorca, you're going to probably have to go through Lisbon. But if you're going to Porto, one of my favorite cities, it's also the home of one of my favorite restaurants. Check out, the name of the restaurant is 1756, and all I can tell you is order the salmon tataki. All right. All right, here we go. Lena is saying hello from Miami, planning a tour next year to Istanbul and then to Greece in July. When do you think the best time to start looking for flights? Well, the answer to that is after September 15th, and then try to do it where you can actually monitor it. You're still looking for it now. You haven't purchased it, so that you can probably lock it down by March, right? But right now, don't book it now. The computers aren't set up to give you a discount. They're going over year projections, and their algorithms are not set up yet to discount anything that far ahead. All right? Okay. Hold on a second. I'm looking here. Somebody's asking for Barcelona restaurant recommendations. I'll give you one. It's not for dinner. It's for lunch. In Las Ramblas, you know where Las Ramblas is in Barcelona. It's a great walking street. There's also the central market, the Boqueria. And if you go in the Boqueria, you're going to see a couple of things before you ever get to my place that I'm going to tell you about. In the old days, the beautiful Serrano ham, it was prohibited from coming to the United States. The agricultural lobby just didn't want it to come in. Now you're allowed to bring it in, which is great. And what you see them sell there is shrink-wrapped, vacuum-sealed Serrano ham. It's amazing. And just make sure you get some. But on the way through all that mess, in the back of the market, there's a little place called Bar Central. Now, I have to warn you, it only has like about 8 stools and maybe 4 chairs and tables. So you may have to wait your turn. But right in front of the counter, they have every kind of fish imaginable just laid out for you. And you just tell them which one you want them to cook, and they cook it right in front of you. It's a great experience and well worth the wait. Bar Central in La Boqueria in Barcelona. Okay. Karen wants to know, when in September do airfares go down to Europe? Well, usually around September 8th. Okay. But we're starting to see some softening right now. I mentioned this on the show a couple of weeks ago, but it just came up again for the first time, that credit card defaults are starting to rise, and they're rising noticeably. At the same time, consumer credit card debt is nearing, fasten your seatbelts, $1 trillion. And so you're looking at what the Federal Reserve Bank looks at as 90-day delinquencies on credit cards, and that's the number that's going up. And because of that, we're seeing a little bit of softening of travel starting in September, not just seasonally, but simply because people can't afford it. You know, during the pandemic, everybody logged on to those great credit card bonus offers. Those credit cards came with 24 to 28% compounded interest. It wasn't pretty, and the bills have come due. So this may be the last really big, big, big summer before people come to their senses, and we might actually see some rational thinking when it comes to airfares, because they have nowhere to go right now but down. They've already gone as high as I think they can go, I hope. So look around September 8th if you can. All right, Colleen says, I'm happy with the tours we've taken with Tauk. However, for Switzerland, I'd not take a tour. The train system is excellent. That's exactly what I said, Colleen, to the other listener, the other watcher. So here we go. Sue is saying, going to the Big Island October 1st, when should I look for airfare? Well, the problem with Hawaii now is there's no seasonality left. It's expensive all year round. Every airline's flying there. And, you know, we're seeing, you know, relatively mediocre hotels getting, you know, $500 to $600 a night. But since you have some time here and since there's no seasonality, start looking for it now. Do not wait. Okay. Okay. John is suggesting a great restaurant in Barcelona. It's P-U-R. Okay. And it has a Michelin star. So get out your wallet. But if John Lample likes the restaurant, it's a good restaurant. All right. Scott's saying hi from Jacksonville. Hello, Jacksonville. Ho, Scott. Let me scroll back up here a second. Now, I asked you guys a question today. And the question was, what's the craziest thing that happened to you on an airplane? All right. And here's what you said. All right. The pilot announcing, this is from Loveline. The pilot announcing that one of the engines has failed and we need to dump fuel and head back to London for an emergency landing. I've had that happen about six times. You know what? When they actually dump the fuel and you look out the window, you just see mist. It vaporizes the minute it leaves the plane. It's wild. But the fact that you wrote me that note means you had a safe landing. Barbara says, I was the only passenger on a United airplane. I love that, Barbara. You know what? That happened to me once, and I'll tell you where it happened to me. It's a great story. We were doing a story in Mexico, right across the border from Yuma, Arizona. So they dropped me back off at Yuma, and in those days, there was one flight a day on United Express from Yuma back to Los Angeles, and it left at like 7 o'clock at night. Well, we were finished with the story at 2 in the afternoon. They just dropped me at the airport. Well, the size of the Yuma airport, roughly the size of the bridge of this ship. And I got in there, other than the one United Airlines clerk and one TSA official, right? One TSA agent, it was me. So there were the three of us there for 5 hours with nothing to do. And the counter agent told me that I was the only passenger on that flight. So we had plenty of time to talk. I learned her story, when she went to school, what she did for a living, her family, her first sexual experience, you name it. We had a great conversation. And the TSA guy and I sat down and shared a Diet Coke together. I mean, we're going nowhere, right? And everything is in a really wonderful conversation, great people. Now the plane lands and it's empty. I'm still the only passenger. And the counter agent, of course, her job was also go out to the plane with the orange cones to load the bags of which there were none, to unload the bags of which there were none, to give the pilots the weight and balance of which there was one. And now it's time for me to go through TSA. And here's the funny part. You cannot make it up. Remember, I've just spent 5 hours with this guy and 5 hours with her. And so I'm still the only person in the airport, but she felt obligated to go to the loudspeaker to announce the boarding of flight. And I'm the only guy there. So I'm laughing. She's laughing. And as I go through the security thing, he says, you've been selected for random secondary screening. Really? Yeah, I mean, it was sort of like Don Knotts and Mayberry RFD. Anyway, that was my experience being the only person on a plane. Okay. Alan says, a passenger heart attack and diverted to Pittsburgh. If that's the only crazy thing that happened to you on a plane, consider yourself lucky. You know how many medical emergencies there are on planes right now every day that you don't know about? And how many of them don't have to divert because there's a reasonably good chance there's a medical personnel on board. It could be an EMT, a nurse, could even be a dentist. I mean, there's somebody there who can help out. And now the real question is, which nobody really wants to talk about, but I will, is what kind of medical equipment are they carrying on planes today to help those medical personnel in the event of an emergency? Well, every airplane in the United States carries a first aid kit. That's about four Johnson & Johnson bandages and good luck. But in the cockpit, there is an emergency medical kit that can only be unlocked and broken out at the command of the pilot, because it does have some narcotics in there. And that's what they are able to use. Interestingly enough, the quality and the complexity of those emergency medical kits on U.S. domestic flights is not great. It really isn't. They don't have enough stuff in there. Although they've now added one additional piece of equipment, which gives you an idea of another bigger problem in America. I was on a flight from New York to Phoenix on American Airlines about, 6 months ago. And they announced there was a medical emergency on the plane. Was there anybody there qualified to help? There were three. Turns out the passenger behind me was sitting in a center seat, was unresponsive. They couldn't wake him. They couldn't even detect a pulse. There were two doctors and a nurse. They tried to get a blood pressure. They tried to get a pulse. And then one of them realized what it was. And he said, break out the medical kit. And what was American Airlines carrying in the medical kit? And I find out that almost every other U.S. airline is carrying a similar piece in their medical kit. Narcan. It was an opioid overdose. And you can either do it as an injection or nasally. They did it nasally with him, and he snapped right out of it, walked off the plane as if nothing happened. The fact that the airlines are now carrying Narcan gives you a pretty good picture of the opioid crisis that's now in the air as well. So there you go. Okay. Eugene writes, this is before takeoff. I couldn't find my seat in economy, but then an air hostess told me, air hostess? Wow, I haven't heard that word in a while. After looking at my ticket, that I'd been upgraded to first class. Didn't they tell you? It would have been business class, but there are no seats left. Congratulations, Eugene. Here's one from Suda. It says, 9 babies. Yes, I counted. Crying nonstop. They took turns, of course, all through the long-haul flight, and everybody in the aircraft losing their marbles. Well, I have a rule, okay? I have a number of rules about travel, so let me share them with you, right? If you check in 2 bags simultaneously, the first bag comes out first, and the second bag comes out never, okay? The later you are for the flight, the further the gate. And then the longer the flight, the better chance that there is a baby sitting right next to you who will cry during the entire flight. So that's what he is. All right, we had a few engine failures here. All right, I'm looking at here. Oh, my goodness. Interesting. We had one, Sandy wrote about circling Miami 12 different times because they could not get the gear to go down. Well, obviously, Sandy, they did get the gear to go down because you're writing me. But that was her experience. Lorraine said, I was on a red-eye nonstop Los Angeles to Newark. The passenger in the middle seat had been boozing it up at the airport bars all night before our flight, and within 30 minutes of takeoff began throwing up and did so for the next few hours while I was stuck in the window seat on a packed flight. Ew. Mm. Okay. Okay. Karen says, I once flew Reno Air from New York to Vegas. The pilot was wearing a cowboy hat and boots, said yeehaw a lot. Okay. And again, you landed. Okay. Kelly had a bird strike on takeoff from the Sacramento airport. You dump fuel and landed safely. Now this is an interesting one. Tina said 3 touch and goes trying to land in San Diego. 3? Oh my goodness. Now we know that Lindbergh Field in San Diego has probably the steepest approach of any major airport in America. You know, you're coming right in over Balboa Park and the San Diego Zoo. If you're sitting on the left side of the plane, you can see what people are doing in their hotel rooms as you're making that final approach. And it's an airport that usually gets the pilot's attention. It's not like a long, slow approach like you might have in Phoenix. But 3 touch and goes? Wow. Wow. That I've never heard of. Okay. Drew says, we missed a takeoff twice and landing on Allegiant. How do you miss a takeoff twice? I'd like to know more details about that. John, the same person who recommended the restaurant in Barcelona, said, One day on U.S. Air out of Philadelphia, hit by lightning and seeing St. Elmo's fire streak from the front of the back of the aircraft, a scary minute indeed. Let me share you with another story about John, who I happen to know. John and I were also on another flight. How about this happening twice? From Heathrow to JFK, and we were about an hour outside of JFK. We got stuck in a major storm. They had closed JFK. We had about another 45 minutes of fuel remaining before we'd have to divert to Boston, which none of us wanted to do, when all of a sudden we heard a big explosion, and that was the plane being struck by lightning. And we saw St. Elmo's fire as well come right through the front of the cabin, all the way through first class, the business and coach, and out the tail. It knocked out most of the avionics in the cockpit. The pilot declared an emergency. He had his manual compass there, about that's all he had left. They opened Kennedy for us, and we landed. And when we got off the plane, at that point, John worked for British Airways. That's the flight we were on. We went to the back. He told me to come down the stairs before we cleared customs. And we went on the tarmac, and we looked at the tail. There was a hole in the tail the size of a small watermelon where the lightning bolt had exited the plane. Needless to say, that plane was taken out of service. But that, so John's telling us that story out of U.S. Air. That means John's seen lightning twice. Wow. John. Okay. I love this one from Winston. Many years ago on a charter flight from JFK to Athens, the plane was so overloaded that we had to refuel three times, Newfoundland, Shannon, and Mallorca. Well, Winston, I don't think it was because the plane was overloaded. It was probably the wrong plane. It was probably not meant for that kind of travel. And it just didn't have the range, all right? Susan says, I looked out the window and saw another jet fly by opposite direction at right about the same altitude and too close for my liking. All right? Tina says, a nose of our plane was struck by lightning. All right, another one. Tony says, after pulling to a gate arriving on a Southwest flight, I had to do a Heimlich maneuver on a woman sitting on the row behind me. Well, good luck. I think she survived. Well, thank you for sending in all of those notes. One more note here again to a little housekeeping. Our Travel Detective series continues on PBS. And in fact, the next episode is airing this week. So it's on PBS, Amazon Prime, and Apple TV Plus. Here's a little preview.
This week on The Travel Detective, have you ever considered buying art at one of those auctions on a cruise ship? And what do you really need to know? How is the art itself made and by whom? What is its real value? Who actually appraised it? And are there any guarantees that what you bought and loved at sea was actually worth what you paid for it once you were ashore? The often controversial world of art auctions at sea. That's our cover story.
Plus, could it be the next generation of flight? Learn about the innovative boutique luxury airline concept in California, Surf Air. And then, it offers some of the best history tours around the world and how one company has created a D-Day itinerary, exploring the beaches of Normandy with a very special World War II historian. I'm Peter Greenberg. All this and more on the next edition of The Travel Detective on PBS. Check your local listings.
So check that out, especially the one about the art auctions on cruise ships. I think you might be enlightened by that. That's one of our investigative pieces. Some more notes here from Colleen. Do most flights have defibrillators? Interesting story about that. For years and years and years, airlines have been lobbied by people to put on the AEDs. And of course, the AEDs that they're making now are foolproof, because they give you audio commands. You don't have to be a medical professional to use them to save somebody's life. And the irony of all ironies, in fact, I've had them on my radio show, is the one man who lobbied American Airlines for years to get them on the plane. The day they put them on the plane, that man was a passenger on the plane and he had a heart attack, the very same guy. And they used that AED to save his life. Talk about timing, right? So that's a very good thing. Here we go. Debbie's saying hello from Boynton Beach. Pat says, an aborted takeoff because they forgot to close the cargo door. Whoops. Sue, the landing gear got frozen and we had a hard landing flying from Newark. All the medical units were waiting. No. If the landing gear got frozen, you tell me it didn't lower or it did lower. That's the key. Hard landing with no landing gear, you would have remembered that a long time. Okay, here we go. Oh, and now it's time for the photo of the week. I love this photo. Congratulations to A.T. Clausen. Where was this taken? The Kaanapali Coast in Maui. There was a brief rain shower followed by the awesome sunset. I love it right after it rains. How can you beat this photo? A.T., nicely done. And if you think you've got a great photo of the week that qualifies, that can compete with A.T.'s, just send it in. And if we agree with you, that's to peter@petergreenberg.com. And if we agree with you, it goes right up on our board. One more housekeeping note, actually two. Remember the 92nd Street Roundtable that starts June 21st. I'll be live from a different location around the world each week, answering questions like what the airlines won't tell you, what the hotels won't tell you, what cruise lines won't tell you, the truth about frequent flyer programs, everything you wanted to know, stuff that you need to know, not just in traveling this summer, but traveling beyond this summer. It's a great program. It's a great organization. I'm proud to be a part of it and to share in the conversation. You can just go to roundtable.org or look at the link that Anthony is now posting. Please sign up for it, and I'll see you starting the 21st of June. And, of course, day after tomorrow, our radio show. And we're going to be having a long conversation with our good friend Mike Boyd about something that we've been talking about a lot on this show, and that's the frequent flyer programs and what's really happening in this long, hot summer of 2023. Have we finally come to grips with what these programs can't deliver, or in some cases, won't deliver? So tune in then. We're about to set sail for Thunder Bay, and then wildfires, hopefully forgiving. I'll be off on a flight to Toronto and then back to the U.S. But we'll see you on the radio on Saturday. I'll see you next week from a truly distant remote location around the world. I'm not going to tell you where, but it's far, far away from here. Have a great rest of your week. Have a great weekend. Please stay safe, and I'll see you soon.